We are built for this network, for the strong, not the weak.
And since the American white man has used his control over the press and over the textbooks and over all forms of media to make it appear that he has done us a favor by bringing us here and enslaving us, then the Honorable Elijah Muhammad has to rewrite history or retell history. And since the white man can't dispute this truth, he tries to defend himself by saying that Mr. Muhammad is teaching hate. It's not hate to say that we were kidnapped and brought here. It's truth. It's not hate to say that we were Jim Crow, discriminated and segregated. It's truth. It's not hate to say that the Supreme Court, which is the highest court in this country, came up with a hypocritical desegregation decision 9 years ago, which they haven't enforced yet. That's not hate. That's truth.
You're quoted as having said when an airliner crashed with a number of white people on board that you were glad it happened.
The white race in this country collectively are guilty of these crimes that our people are suffering from collectively, and therefore they would suffer some collective disaster, collective grief. And when that plane crashed in France with 130 white people on it, and we learned that 120 of them were from the state of Georgia, the state that my own grandfathers was a slave in, why, to me, it couldn't have been anything but an act of God, a blessing from God, and I frankly and sincerely pray for similar blessings from him to repeat themselves as often as he can spare them.
But I take it then you support the freedom-loving attempts of the peaceful marchers in Alabama and these places.
You don't get freedom peacefully. Freedom is never safeguarded peacefully. Anyone who is depriving you of freedom isn't deserving of a peaceful approach by the ones who are being deprived of their freedom. And when black people in this country come out from under the mental straitjacket that the Negro clergymen have placed them in, and begin to see that the only way you can get freedom is to get it the same way the white man in this country got it from England, or he says he got it from England. He was willing to pay the price for freedom. When you're willing to pay the price for freedom, then you'll get it. But the Negro in this country has never been willing to pay the price for his freedom. All of the price that we've been paying in the past has been freedom for the white man. We fought abroad so that the white man in America could be free today, to sick police dogs on us, to beat our people in the heads with police clubs, and to turn water holes on little women and children and babies simply because they want to walk down the street like decent human beings. That's now the only way you can have peace is to eliminate those injustices, and the American white man is not going to eliminate them. He's going to talk that pretty talk, but he'll still continue to practice those inhuman deeds.
You got the Honorable Elijah's message yourself behind prison walls.
When I was a Christian, I committed many crimes, and those crimes led to my own imprisonment. And also led to my being very atheistic, agnostic first and then atheistic. And it was only after hearing the religious teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad that I became religious and was able to reform myself and rehabilitate myself. But I learned that after trying to reform and rehabilitate myself, that the American white man was more against me then than he was when I was a criminal, when I had criminal tendencies and was trying to carry out or practice his Christianity.
Do you blame Christianity for your crimes?
Christianity is one of the real causes of most of the condition that black people in this country are confronted with. It's the religious concept that Christianity has given Negroes in this country that makes us almost incapable of solving our own problems. The black man in this country has a different religious concept when he's a Christian than the white man has. If you notice, the black man is the only one who will turn the other cheek to his enemy, or who will love his enemy, or who will pray for those who despitefully use him just because he thinks that's what Jesus wants him to do. Now, the white man preaches the same thing, but he doesn't practice it.
Now, this refusal to integrate, surely it must lead to demands for your own state in America.
The black people in this country have been like a misfit wife married to the white man here who hasn't treated us right. And today, since we have given up all hope of him ever changing, we want a divorce. We want a complete separation, but we want a property settlement. And we think that the white man, we think that the American government should give us a property settlement, which means part of this country, which they robbed from the Indians, with our help, and which they have worked up to make the kind of land that it is today.
Do you think this really practical? Don't you think that the future really lies with a peaceful transformation of the scene?
if the American government, the Supreme Court, the President of the United States, the Congress and the Senate, and all these white liberals have said that they're for integration, and these Negroes haven't gotten any more integration than they have, why, that's more impractical than separation. Practical means that which you can practice. And if the Supreme Court and the Army and the Navy and the government and the President are supposed to be for integration and you still can't get it, why, good night, you can't get it. It's impossible. But we can get separation overnight because we already have it.
Mr. Malcolm, thank you very much.
You're welcome, sir. I thank you for letting the people over in Europe know what the white man in this country is doing to black people and the hypocrisy he's practicing when he accuses them over there of not getting their house in order. 20 million black people in this country have been just as thoroughly colonized by the American white man in a more shrewd, modern way than all of the colonized people in Angola, South Africa, or any other part of this world. But the white man over here hides his own dirt by constantly pointing toward Britain and France and Portugal and these other countries and accusing them of being colonial powers when he mastered colonialism before those countries ever knew what it was.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
What's happening, everybody? It's your man, HRap, coming at you live and direct. This is Build for This Network. This is a show called Build and Destroy. I come to you this Saturday. It's been a couple changes. I had some technical difficulties. I had to do a couple extra things. That's why you don't have any background music. But that'll be eradicated as soon as humanly possible. I am here to continue what I've been doing, you know, promote Build for This Network. And this show is personally called Build and Destroy, whereas I talk about things that are concerned in our community, and hopefully we can come up with some excuses, resolutions instead of excuses. You know how I start each and every one of my shows. I send out homage to my ancestors, and with that, you send out homage and respect to them, and you will get blessings and protections in return. This is why I address each and every one of my ancestors before every show. I start with the people who are related to me that are connected to the Whitmore family, the Pollard family, the Turner family, the Battle family, the Cotton family, the Harper family, the Baileys, the Crisp, the Lansdowns, the Lincolns, the Duncans, and the Williams. And everybody already know me and my pops. We are the Williams clan and we are in the building. Much love. Thank you for tuning in. This is a podcast. Nothing has changed. Just the technology has changed a little bit. This is a podcast. You don't have to catch it live. It is appreciated that you catch it live, but it is not a demand. This is something that you can catch on any podcast app that you are using, Alexa, anything of that nature, YouTube, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, iHeartRadio, Google Cast, CastBox, Deezer, Podcast Addict, and iTunes. If those are the options you use. You can use Alexa. You can use Google Dot. Whatever you're using to stream your podcast, you can get in touch with us in that fashion. And again, man, thanks for tuning in to Build and Destroy. What I'm going to do today is I'm going to address a bunch of things that are simply on my mind. And I'm going to be 100% honest with you. These are just things that are swimming around in my head. I didn't even write anything down. There's so much going on. I didn't write anything down this weekend because, you know, you turn on your television and you see madness. You see chaos. You see people disrespecting communities, people attempting to turn narratives, people doing all kinds of wicked things. So you can either A, deter what's going on in the real situation, or you can continue to promote bullshit and try to get people to look in other directions. Now, we are witnessing live a uprising. Hopefully, people will not just stop right here and they will continue to do what the necessary work in order to get things changed. I don't have a whole lot of faith in it, but I am going to continue to do what I have, do what I can do to push forward the work. Just because I don't have a lot of faith in it, that does not mean I'm not going to try to make it change. Because at the end of the day, you cannot change people. You can strengthen your base, but you cannot change people. This is just my simple opinion. Hopefully I am wrong. Hopefully this isn't the way it's going to be. It's just I've watched these things several times over, and I've come to realize that people are not, in most cases, are not willing to change. But even with that, I'm willing to work toward change. And if it's not a nationwide change, hopefully it's a change in our communities. Because, see, we are, again, I don't think we can change other people's mind, because those are mindsets that were created hundreds of years ago. And if you cannot hope to change other people's mind in a 3, 5, 9, 10 year period. But what you can do is change your point of view. What you can do is change your behavior, and you can strengthen your community by doing what you think is necessary in the community to get things taken care of. And that's what my focus is. I don't think other cultures, because here's the thing. If you look around the United States of America, I can't speak about the world because I'm not a world traveler on that level. But if you look around the United States of America, things are being fed to other cultures on a daily basis. There's propaganda, there's lies, there's a bunch of nonsense that's being pumped into the houses of people every day. I was talking to a friend this week, very good friend this week, and I was telling him, and he was talking about change and how he hopes things will change. And I was telling him, I don't think it's going to be a change simply because, take yourself out of your skin and put yourself in someone else's skin for a second. Have you ever seen anybody else committing crimes on the news? Then you see occasional white guy, and then you see the occasional Arab guy who they want to call a terrorist or something of that nature. And that's further propaganda to turn you against people. But when I'm a criminal justice major, for those who are just listening to the show for the first time, when I was graduating from school, I was taught that the two biggest gangs in the world are the Russian Mafia and the Asian Mafia. This isn't a disparaging thing against the Asian or Russian communities. This is just what crime statistics and FBI statistics and things of that nature worldwide will tell you. If you are telling me that these are the two biggest illegal organizations that run the world, why don't you see Asian crime reported on the news? Why don't you see the Asian Mafia is doing this, and they're wrecking havoc, and they're doing things that are disrupting the community? You'd never hear that. You just see people that look like me and you on TV. So if they're pumping a narrative that includes us and focuses primarily on us, why would anybody else assume that other people are doing crimes? So that's why I said it's almost impossible to change other people's point of view. And at the end of the day, I'm going to keep it all the way 100 with you. I really don't give a damn what people think about our community. Now, what I do care about is how we move forward. And that's what I believe all of us should be worried about. Because it's easy to get caught up in, this is the way we look in front of. But at the end of the day, does it really make a difference to you what somebody think of you? In my opinion, it shouldn't. It really shouldn't. Because if people are looking at someone else's narrative and they jump into conclusions on who you are and what you are, then that person wants to feel that way. That person clearly wants to feel that way about you. And if that's what he's chose to do, he's going to do it. You can explain and explain. We've all gone through that. You know, you can be a nice guy or a nice woman, and for whatever reason, other people say, I don't like him, and they recruit other haters. And I hate that term, but that's the only thing I can come up with. They recruit other people who are antithesis of who you are, and that's how a narrative is created around you. And that narrative may never dissipate until you have one-on-one interaction with some of those people, and they go, hey man, I always thought you were this kind of way. And it's strange how people who've never interacted with you, never had a conversation with you, never been privy to your personality, the way you act, they've formed an identity in their mind for you. And that's what's happening in the United States of America. Most people are not around our community. Most people don't know anybody. Like they say, I saw a statistic this week. I think it was either 75 or 95. I think let's go with the lower number just for argument's sake. 75% of white people in America have never been around black people. They are only around white people. So if you spend all of your time around someone, away from someone, how in the hell could you possibly form an idea or a narrative about who they are? But that's what we deal with on a regular basis. That's why I say, hey, I'm not focusing. I'm never going to crack open the mic and start telling you what we can do to gain the respect of the population at large. Because one thing I do know, most people that interact with people from our community have an affinity for our community. You know, we love to brag about clothing and style and things of that nature. But you know what? I can sum it up with one statement. Other cultures love our rhythm, but they hate our blues. And what I mean by that is this. Everybody wants to dance like us. Everybody want to hang out with us. Everybody want to laugh. You love Michael Jordan. You love our entertainers. You love our swag. But when I say, yeah, man, I got a headache. So what? That's your damn business. But when other people's headaches are put in front of us, we're expected to have empathy. We're expected to rise above. And like, again, speaking to the same friend, we have narrative. And this is no knock against Mrs. Obama. I got mad respect for the lady. But like she said, when they go low, we go high. Sorry, Mrs. Obama, I am not going to go high. If you go low on me, I'm going to kick you in the face. And that's just how I'm getting down going forward. It's easy to make those little narratives and those little bromites. And it shows class. Again, Mrs. Obama, I don't have that kind of class. I don't have that kind of decorum. And I'm tired. You know, at the end of the day, I'm just tired. People in my community have not attacked anyone by and large. We are not subjecting people to our tyranny, by and large. What we are doing is struggling in a situation to, as I alluded to at the beginning of the conversation, no foundation. And it's our job to create a foundation so we can move forward. Once we move forward with our foundation, we can establish a community. And we can move forward and establish something that will get us put in the best possible situation. And we won't continue to struggle. Otherwise, if we don't start to create something, a base, so to speak, if we don't create this base at some point, we will suffer the consequences. To quote the most honorable Elijah Muhammad, do for self or suffer the consequences. At this point, we're suffering the consequences because we're not doing for self. We're trying to accommodate people who have no interest in accommodating us. So what we'll have to do as a community is continue to get to know each other first and foremost. Because the reason we don't embrace each other is because we don't know each other. And it's okay to be different. That's something else that we need to start embracing. It's okay for you to love Jesus and me to love the Prophet Muhammad and somebody else to love Buddha and somebody else to love Jehovah Jireh. That's okay. You know, because you know what? What I've noticed in my lifetime and through hours upon hours of evolution and years upon evolution is this. No matter what spiritually based organization that you are part of or whatever faith that you follow, that faith helps you be the best person you can be. So as a community, we need to embrace the fact that you're different from me in that way. But at the end of the day, we have more things in common than we have different. And until, as a community or as a people as a whole, we embrace that thought, we will continue to struggle because I don't have to like what you like. All I have to do is respect you as a human being. And more than likely, me and you will get along just fine. Or as people say, swimmingly. But it seems that we have issues with that. And let's end those issues now. Let's just redefine those issues right now. Because we're suffering the consequences of not being able to relate to each other. We can agree. We can disagree without being disagreeable. You know, we have to. We have to realign the deeds of what we call a black person. The first thing is this. Let's stop welcoming every single person who does something nice to us in the quote unquote cookout. You can be an ally. And you don't have to come to the cookout. You know, this week is a perfect example of what I'm talking about. I don't understand why people are so upset with Drew Brees. Drew Brees said this 3 years ago when Colin Kaepernick first started his mission. He said the exact same words. And now we're upset that he's showing us who he is. Drew Brees isn't, I don't think he's an ally or enemy. He's just who the hell he is. And when people show you who they are, you back up off of them. And now he's apologetic and he's attacking the president and things of that nature. He's trying to gain favor again. But you know what? The easiest way to gain favor is to work through what you have to work through. Do your work and you're fine. We don't have any, I don't have any enemies on this earth. Now, if you attack me or you attack anyone in my community, now you got a problem. But I'm not, you know, I'm not worried about you liking me, you know what I mean? Oh, man, this dude, oh, they need to start dropping balls and they should let him get knocked the hell out. No, they shouldn't, because guess what? Every single solitary play that you play in the National Football League is recorded. And when you, as a player, don't live up to your responsibility, they replace you. So why would we ask one of our young soldiers who has the financial wherewithal to help boost up our community and create that foundation that I spoke about? Why would we say, nah, take that $2, $3, $4, $10, $20, $100 million out of your pocket that you could bring back to the community and reestablish who we are? Take that out your pocket and sacrifice for the greater good. That does nothing for the greater good. What we have to do, and I spoke on this Tuesday, what we have to do is reestablish ourselves as men and women in our community. And then we can give those young men guidance and teach them not to have a knee-jerk reaction, not to do this and do that. All you have to do is this. I played defense. I played football on defense. We really didn't rock with the offense too much. But we were all one team. Perfect example, Chicago Bears, their defense and offense, they didn't have, it wasn't at odds. It just was two different entities. When Drew Brees does something spectacular or he gets a whole lot of praise, instead of high-fiving and all that and they're skinning and grinning, you sit down in the cut because, hey, you've drawn a line in the sand. I'm going to stay on this line, man, because you know what? Shannon Sharpe said it, I heard it, and a bunch of us have echoed it. He was speaking from his core. And when you're speaking from your core, he didn't say he hates black people. He just said, I don't give a damn about what y'all going through. And that's cool with me as well. I'm not going to spend any time hating Drew Brees. I'm not going to spend any time hating anybody that looks like Drew Brees. What I'm going to do is do what I did 3 years ago when he said the nonsense. I just erased Drew Brees from my prayer view. And when you do that, it's easy, man. You ain't got to love Drew Brees. Drew Brees is one of about, 1,800 players in the National Football League. And if you don't pay attention to him, you got a whole league of people to do this. Now, another thing, since I'm talking this football thing, the National Football League insulted the hell out of me. And you too. More than likely you too. It's other people from other communities that listen. But I'm speaking directly to my folks right now. They insulted the hell out of us. We admitted that we were wrong about Colin Kaepernick. No shit, Sherlock. But again, this is why we don't have to run out and buy 15 t-shirts and 15 hats, jackets, jerseys, and so forth and so on. We can still like the teams. We can still support them. But this is, hey, as long as you've been hearing my voice, you've been hearing me say, these people don't give a damn about us. They give a damn about our money. And see, this is why we keep having problems. Because we assume that this is our team. This is our get down. This is no, it's their get down and we like it. It's just like a movie. None of us expect United Artists or any other or Sony or any of these filmmakers to be down with us. We go patronize their movies. Enjoy football. If you want to buy a t-shirt and hat and a jersey, do that. You want to rep with your folks, you do that. If you want to start arguing with me, Raiders versus whoever, Raiders Bears versus whoever, let's do that. But let's not fall out with each other anymore because we understand there has been a line drawn in the sand. And because they realize this uprising is an international phenomenon, now they want to be on our side. And I'm not trying to be on anybody's side, but the folks that are on my side. That's how we combat this anger and removing yourself and me. Oh, man, let's not watch football and let's not watch this and let's not watch that. If that's what you enjoy, you do it. If that's what you enjoy, you do it. Hey, I don't have an issue with it. You know, a lot of people say, hey, let's withdraw. There are other things that we can withdraw from that have more of a direct impact on things. For example, all of a sudden, all these Fortune 500 companies, S&P 500, these NASDAQ index and New York Stock Exchange index companies are coming out. Bank of America want to pledge this much money, and these people want to pledge this much money. You know what? Stop pledging money to these charitable organizations. If you really want to help my community, in my personal opinion, what you do is you go to these quote-unquote inner cities, because inner cities is a dog whistle for where black folks live, and start pumping money into them schools. Reopen some of these institutions of academics. That's what you do. Fund some of these after-school programs. Don't give the money to the NAACP. Don't give the money to the Urban League. Don't give the money to wherever you're going. Go into some of these cities. Chicago Bears, New York Giants, New York Jets, Dallas Cowboys, Houston Texans, New Orleans Saints, and so forth and so on. Bank of America. You did, just when I say Bank of America, I think about how many people Bank of America and these prime lenders and subprime lenders snatch wealth out of our community, because land, homes, and property is wealth. And when you foreclosed on all those homes and you gave out all those subprime lending loans, so and you took our tax dollars to make sure your ass stayed afloat, but you kept all my brothers and sisters out of their homes, so gentrification continued to sweep the west, north, and south side of Chicago and making it unlivable for a regular working class person. How about this? Go find those people. Since you want to give up $1 billion, Bank of America, go find all those people who foreclosed on their homes. Get them home rehabilitation loans and put them back in their houses. If you really give a damn about black people, but they don't, because land is power in this country. Land is power wherever you at. If you own the land, you got a little power. And now, guess what? You can refinance your house and pay for your son, your grandson, your granddaughter, education. You can do that. But they ain't doing that. Hey, man, big ups to Michael Jordan for pledging $100 million, but that's another situation. Go into some of these communities, Mike, and all these other people. Start helping people reestablish themselves in the financial world. And the best way to reestablish yourself in the financial world is put somebody in a home. Point blank, period. And don't juice the loan and don't put the red line in, because, hey, what we don't realize is redlining is still a thing. I know somebody who knows someone who has a house that he purchased that says black people not supposed to be able to buy this house. So how do you sign a contract and the fine print says you're not supposed to be able to live there? That means that they can take that house from you if they want to, or they can use finagling, or they can finagle things and then get your ass out your crib. See, these are the things. If you want to help my community, don't give money to charitable organizations. There are people with boots on the ground every day. There's somebody at every one of these jobs, every one of these tall, pretty ass builders in Chicago, every one of these medium builders in Chicago, and all throughout the United States of America, the hospitals and office buildings who lost their homes. Find those people, put them back in their homes. Put people, if you really want to put back people back to work, and y'all pledging all this goddamn money, that's how you do it, man. Put people back on their feet. But nah, we won't do that, because we just want to posture and give away money to invisible entities that's not going to help anybody in particular. And I get it. I get it, man. I really do. Nobody who has power wants to give up that power. And if you don't want to give up that power, that's cool. But stop pretending. Stop smiling in my face and kicking me in my fucking face. Smiling me in my face and kicking me in my ass, excuse me. That's what I meant to say. Stop smiling in my face and kicking me in my ass and telling me you're my friend, but you're not doing anything that a friend would do. So Bank of America, it's cool. It sounds good that you're going to give away all this damn money and it's all good and we're going to help the brothers and the sisters out and we down with change. Yeah. How about this, Bank of America? Miss Jackson, you know what? I'm looking at the chat room right now on the new system. Rhonda S. and Shelly Q. Why don't you promote Rhonda and Shelly and give them the ability to hire Miss Unique and Low Key? How about that? Or won't you give them the ability to hire D-Grade and Joe from Houston or Big Illinois? How about that? If you really want to create diversity, if you really want to help, start hiring people that look like me. Start allowing them to work in your work in your universe and give them the same power that you give everybody else. Damn, and there goes some fucking help right there. But that's not happening. You just pledge your money to entities that more than likely you have somebody on the back end controlling, and then me and my brothers and my sisters never see that damn money. So y'all could be, oh man, well see, they trying to do stuff. They not trying to do anything. They trying to bamboozle you. They trying to calm you down. They trying to put you in a subdued state of mind so people could take their asses back in the house, and they hope this uprising will stop and they can get right back to business. That's what they're doing. And it's some people who listen to my podcast from other cultures say, see, folks ain't never happy. We trying to get them money and blah, blah, blah. But you're not giving us money. You're giving entities money. You're not putting that money into a youth center in my community so our young people can learn music, learn art, learn how to act, learn how to write, learn how to do anything in their leisurely time. You're not making sure the schools on the south and west side of Chicago and South Central and the Bronx and the west side of Atlanta, and I could go on and on, have the exact same education facilities that as our white counterparts. That's what you're not doing. You're just blowing smoke up people's ass, and I'm tired of it. It sound good. Oh, man, well, we're going to look out for the brothers. When? But y'all not. So that's something else. This is why I'm talking about this, you know. And then it's just, you know, when you got union chiefs calling Black Lives Matter a terrorist group. See, this is the kind of rhetoric that, you know what, you know, the thing that annoys me the most, union chiefs and the president of the United States and other people calling anytime we organize a terrorist situation. It's a terrorist situation. Well, I know for sure that it was a government funded by President Abraham Lincoln organization called the Ku Klux Klan. That's a terrorist organization. I never hear anybody say these white nationalist groups are terrorist organizations. I never hear that. How is that possible? You've had these groups around for 160 fucking years, and nobody's trying to destroy them like you did the Black Panther Party, self-defense, like you did the Student Nonviolent Coalition, like you did the Great Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., like you did the Nation of Islam. They're the boogeymen. It is literally and figuratively pure madness when you hear these things. This is why you have to start saying, you know what, maybe these folks are not going to change. I mean, and I'm not telling you not to have faith. I'm just saying maybe you need to look at it a different way and start trying to work with people who you've had difficult situations with inside of our community. And then if we can do that, then we can move forward. And if we don't do that, we will suffer the consequences. You know, I even had a person in my life this week during the uprising challenge the Nation of Islam. This dude literally wrote on Facebook, "I thought the Nation of Islam was supposed to protect us, or was that just talk?" Really, bruh? Really, bruh? Are you kidding me? But see, and this is a dude who would consider himself an activist, an ally. No ally will put that into the universe the way he did. And more than likely, he's listening. And at this point, I really don't give a hot goddamn. Be mad at B. You know what I mean? You ain't going to be the first one. Tell you what, page 37 on my bad guy resume, it's a slot open. Put that shit right there, man. It's right there for the, hey, that whole line, that whole page open. Put that on my bad guy resume. I let the rest of the world view it as well. But it's just that kind of backbiting, or as my mama would call it, flow showing, that gets us in a bad situation. Because now you have attacked an organization that has not done anything wrong to the community at large. You may have some questions about what this and what that and this leader, that leader. But by and large, the Nation of Islam has brought no harm to our community on no level. People who hate them are going to hate them today. I don't give a damn if Louis Farrakhan cures AIDS, cancer, and corona by the end of this show. It's going to be somebody standing around saying his black ass should have did it last year. So when you attack the Nation of Islam as a member of our community for an unfounded reason, then you're part of the problem and not part of the solution. We don't have time for this, people. We really don't have time to be throwing rocks and stones at each other. If you are part of that get down, you are really part of the faction of us that are trying to destroy us. You are looking for fame, you are looking for prosperity, and you are looking for the destruction of our community, in my personal opinion. Then, speaking of people who are looking for the destruction of our community, you got these dudes like Jesse Lee Wright, you got this chick Candace Owens, who are true enemies to the culture. Am I telling you to hate them? Hell no, I'm not. But we have to be able to identify who the enemies are inside of our community. I ain't going to tell you to hate these people, even though I'm right there. I'm hating the hell out of them. Because personally, Candace Owens is a cancer. Jesse Lee Wright is a cancer. You know, and we continue to see, they're the perfect example of what I talk about on my sports show. Stop giving me stats and give me facts. Give me facts about what's going on. Because, black people, the black on black statistic. Okay, if you don't get the hell out of that, here with that, Candace. Then Candace comes up and says that this brother Floyd was a criminal in his lifetime. Miss Owens, that is the most egregious situation in your life. Mr. Floyd has participated in some criminal activity. But guess what? Mr. Floyd was a hardworking man who was working two jobs as a truck driver and as a bouncer. So when you want to bring up his history, since we want to bring up history, I just need Miss Owens to go in her purse or her wallet or wherever she keep her money and look at any one of those bills. Those dudes on those bills are rapists, thieves, and looters. How the hell do you think you're living in this country without rapists, thieves, and looters? So when you want to highlight people with statistics and bring out charts, it's only one chart to bring up. People came their ass over here and destroyed, pretty much eradicated a nation of people. You also have people who were copper colored. Guess who? It's only one copper colored people on the earth, y'all. I'm just saying. It's copper colored people who were here before me. And for those who don't want to bleed rap, that's all you have to do. Look up Skip Gates for those who don't know who Skip Gates is. That's Dr. Henry Louis Gates from Harvard University. He does this lineage thing and it's all cool and it's cuddly and it's warm and it makes everybody feel good. Look up Skip Gates. Look up the fact that he did the lineage thing on MC Black Thought from the Roots. The lead MC of the Roots, and he traced his family back to the 1400s. So if we were all bought here, how the hell was Black Thought's family here? But that's a whole other conversation for another show. So, Miss Owens, if you want to tell us about the looters and the criminals and we're always uplifting the worst in our communities, how the hell do we, I can guarantee you, if I put it in the chat room right now, what's your favorite movie? Name the top 10 movies. 99% of the people who will ever listen to this, The Godfather, Goodfellas, and other nefarious movies that are uplifting white criminals will be on that list. So it's not just us lifting up other people. Look, every community on the face of this earth has a criminal element. Correction. Every community in the United States of America. So again, I'm not a world traveler on that level. I've been a few places, but I haven't been enough places that I could make that statement that I just made. But I can make this. Every community in the United States of America has a criminal element. Most communities who are quote unquote on top at this point have made it that to that point because of that criminal element. So when you want to say we uplift our criminals, well, I'm going to need you to never say anything nice about your boy in the White House, one of the biggest crooks in the history of the world. I'm going to need you to never talk about Bill or George Bush and his crew, either one of the Bushes, the Reagan crew, the Nixon crew, the Ford crew, the Carter crew, and I can go all the way back to the very beginning for Mr. Washington and his crew, who By the way, if it wasn't for a brother treating them with malaria, teaching them how to immunize against malaria, they ass would have died. But that, again, allow me to digress. We continue to fall for these things with these dumbass statistics that are half cocked. Again, I always say this on every show. If you want to tell me about black on black crime, I also need you to compare it to something. You can't say, yo, HRap, you got the best podcast I ever heard. What other podcast you listen to? I don't listen to nobody but you. Well, my podcast might suck, homie. You just might like me. So in order to give me credit for a good podcast, you must listen to every podcast on Spreaker, every podcast on, or a whole lot of podcasts on Spreaker, and a whole lot of other outlets. And then you can make that determination. And if you don't do it that way, then you're going to have a problem. And I'm not accepting that praise, but we are willing to accept people tearing us down with no problem. We're going to have to stop that, folks. We definitely going to have to stop that. Because if you are to believe anybody that's telling you any, giving you any statistics, and you tell, I got it from here. Okay, that's cool. You can have it from there. I don't have a problem with you having it from there. But for you to believe into something, lock, stock, and barrel, without looking at the picture in its totality, makes you a damn fool. It really does. It makes you a damn fool. And if you don't mind being a damn fool, I don't mind calling you one. But most people don't want to be damn fools. Nobody wants to be looked upon as an idiot. So we're going to have to stop falling for the proverbial banana in the tailpipe. And if you don't mind falling for the banana in the tailpipe, it's good, man. It's for you, man. The banana ain't for me, family. It ain't for me. I'm sorry. I can't keep falling for the banana in the tailpipe. But now, if we no longer want to do that, what we're going to have to do is organize. And to organize, it is going to take a boatload of things. First, we're going to have to understand the people who are opposing us. And in order to understand the people who are opposing us, we're going to have to pay attention to them. And as we pay attention, we will learn from them. And as we learn from them, we will improve our own standing in this United States, in these United States of America, because once you understand what you're up against, you're able to fight against that thing. And if you don't understand what you're up against, you suffer the consequences. For example, again, another conversation I was having this week, a college educated friend of mine made the statement, is it legal what Donald Trump is doing? Yes, it was. It can be summed up in what is called the Insurrection Act. It's the Insurrection Act. If you find it, and it has been enacted when the sisters in Arkansas was trying to go to school, Lyndon Baines Johnson enacted, your boy Abraham Lincoln enacted it. So this is why when you see him do things, you need to be able to attack him. But as you know about the Insurrection Act, you must also know that what he did by turning those rubber bullets on those people, that's an impeachable act. So once we start understanding the laws of the land, and the brother Anu speaks about this on a regular basis on the cookout, once we know the lay of the land, then we can fight properly. Anger is a worthless emotion. It really is. I'm mad at you. Who gives a hot goddamn if you're mad? But if you want to use that energy that anger brings about and immerse it into information and use that information to properly fight the people who are opposing us, that's when it becomes worth something. At the end of the day, we cannot continue to do these things, man. We are not built for this nonsense and these emotional outbursts. We can't survive or sustain in that realm. I'm sorry, we can't. I'm mad. Most of us have never done anything productive after saying, I'm mad, a motherfucker. Usually end up going to sleep. But we've been asleep long enough. So once we understand what we're fighting against, it's time to say, okay, this is what we're up against. This is what we need to do. And this is how we get it done. Now, I got the homie Jungle in the chat room. Man, look, shout out to the homie Jungle for one. Man, let me give the man some peas, man. You know, this brother Jungle, brother, stopped talking to me for about 6 months because I said I wouldn't vote. He was thoroughly upset. And I'm like, what the fuck, man? What is he so upset about? So I started looking into it. And I'm going to give Jungle, brother, the credit for changing my mind on it, man. Now, do I believe in the system? I still believe the way I believe, Jungle. But what I have done is come up with a way to attack the system in a different fashion. And what I mean by that is this. I understand that there are certain finances, there are certain advantages, and there's certain information out there that by voting, we can slow down this avalanche, this boulder that's rolling downhill at us, and we can put it in a situation that we can stop it or create a dam so our town won't drown. You see what I'm saying? So, yes. Voting is the way. Oh man, rap, these politicians ain't shit, blah blah blah, this, that, and the third. Not a problem. I totally agree. But what we have to do is do exactly what they did 160 years ago at the end of the Civil War, after the Reconstruction. You had people in government after 10 years. So that means in 2030, if we do this properly, we can get a foot. We are far more advanced than our ancestors were at that time. So if we get our foot in the door, we're going to kick that door open and everybody going to run in. Right. And this is what we're going to do. This is what we're going to do. We're going to start developing. There are people like myself. There are people like me. There are millions of us that actually care. So we're going to get some precinct captains. Then we're going to get some aldermen or alder people or whatever the hell you're aldermen. And we're going to get some city councilmen. And we're going to decide who's going to be on our city council. We're going to decide who's going to be the president of our school board. We're going to decide. We're going to start voting for everything, including the damn dog catcher. Because once you have your people in play, your policies can be, those policies that are against you can be slowed down. And guess what else? Then you'll find out about things like land banks. A lot of us don't realize the way they take our houses with eminent domain is because we are paying for the house and the land of somebody else's. When you go to the city hall and find out, look into the land bank or the county clerk and find out where the land bank is, you can buy the land and the house. And when you buy the land and the house, now eminent domain does not apply for you. That's why a lot of these little churches over here by the United Center, they got $100 million building or $200 or $300 million building at the time. And guess what? They got little bitty churches that's right there in the midst of that parking lot because those churches own that land and they own that building. And that's what getting into government does for you. And I'm going to talk about Lightfoot and Obama a little bit later. And I ain't got nothing bad to say about either one of them. But I am going to give them some peas. But once we understand those things, then we get things cracking. So once we get the information, we vote and we put in. And then, as I stated on two of previous shows, and I'm going to keep repeating this because I'm not going to act like everybody heard the shows that I said before. I'm going to continue to incorporate. Each show is going to be a tapestry, so to speak. Like I said, once we get our young people interested in politics, our young people interested in being attorneys, our young people interested in being doctors and so forth and so on, and then we'll move forward and destroy what's trying to destroy us. It looks as if we got a lot of allies from other communities. Hey, while they're out there fighting, we need to be organizing. A lot of people, no, we need to be out there with them. Hey, I didn't create racism. You didn't create racism. As a community, we didn't create racism. So that's really not our fight. The white soldiers out there, the Latino soldiers out there, those all them other cultures who created some who allow other people to put perceptions of who we are in their head. That's their fight. You created disease called racism. Now it's time for you to put your scientists in the room and eradicate that disease like they fighting against this COBRA thing. So what we're going to do is, while they're fighting a good fight, we're going to go out there and push them way into the front, and we'll be in the back. And while we're in the back, we're going to organize. We're going to, again, put people in office, city council. We're going to put people in all kinds of positions, because guess what? We all know how to, well, most of us, I'm not going to insult nobody. We all know how to read. We all are able to learn. And we all should be articulate enough to disseminate what's wrong with our neighborhoods. For example, a sister in my neighborhood, me and her guy, when I'm walking to my car, they or to and from my car, they see me, they speak every day. His sister rolled up on me today and she said, "Hey, you came home the other night at this time, 5 minutes before you rolled up. Somebody robbed me and took my car." This is a nice lady, man. She lived two doors over from me. And this goes back to another point I've been making since I've been on air 4.5 years now. We have to get in contact with each other. You must be able to reach out to your neighbors. Yo, everybody in your neighborhood, we need to get to know them again. And now I know these people. Now I'm going to create a friendship with these people. Name is Joyce, and her significant other name is Lloyd. They carjacked this woman, man. What kind of bullshit is that? But, like I've been saying, if we know each other in the neighborhood, and we see these people in our neighborhood that don't belong, or they got nefarious or wicked ways about them, we need to be like, "Hey, man, what you doing over here, man?" But see, going forward, I changed numbers with the lady, and if Lloyd is at work and I'm at home, she gonna text me when she getting out of the car, and I'm gonna walk to her car, I'm gonna walk to her door. Going forward, we gotta do that kind of stuff. These are just the basic foundations of how to recreate our community. Because if I'm not willing to help, and he not willing to help my family, and we not willing to help the family across the street, we are still in the exact same situation that we're in presently. How the hell we living in a community where somebody is robbing somebody of their hard-earned stuff, and ain't nobody saying nothing, man? Ain't nobody saying nothing. But going forward, your boy Rap is going to be saying something, man, because I'm not allowing this on my watch. Point blank, period. So if we continue to do these things and continue to grow our community, instead of always laughing, joking, dancing, shitting with shits and giggles all the time, we're going to be able to eradicate these things, man. We will. We will identify the people who are opposing us. It ain't the Republican Party that's against us. It ain't the Democratic Party that's against us. It's the system that's against us. I don't know of one person who can be friends with a bigot from my community. Oh, well, he hate these people. Well, you know what? He hates your black ass too. And you sitting around and kiki and ha-ha. But that's what the Republicans and Democrats do. Well, he says he hates black people, but he only hate some black. No, 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 no. Anytime you got people, for example, Hillary Clinton, the last savior of the people that we had. Now, Hillary Clinton's hero is Margaret Sanger. That's the lady who invented the damn the abortion joints. She said that we were a germ that need to get rid of. There's no way in hell Adolf Hitler can be my hero. There's no way. If you are saying that these people, your hero is somebody who said, "I need to be removed from the earth, that we're nothing more than monkeys," how is that your hero? And how are you doing your bidding for me? It can't be done. Joe Biden, is his hero is Strom Thurmond, a bigot. How are these people your heroes? That means you are no different than Trump. Now, you might bullshit a little better. See, that's the thing. Everybody like Bill Clinton and hate George Bush. All it was Bill Clinton was a better liar. So you want to be bullshitted out your socks instead of just having to do bullshit you. But that's what we do. But we don't identify enemies. Now, like a lot of us watch television, a lot of us read, and when you see things like Lord of the Rings and Game of Thrones, you see whereas these people get tired of fighting and they come to the table, and even though I don't like your ass over here, I'm going to deal with you because I'm tired of my people dying. That's the mentality that we need to have. Republicans, Democrats, my ass. All of y'all in the same game. What we going to do is create our own get down. Brother Malcolm spoke about this, and other civil rights activists spoke about this. Or we create a PAC, a political action council, so we can get things in done for us, no matter who it is, because the Republican Party has identified it. That's why you see so many people in the Republican Party angling towards black men, because they think that we're weak like their men, that we don't want to celebrate our sisters as they win, because they don't. Brothers been following sisters, hell, since Sister Harriet, since the Joint of Truth, since Ida B. Wells, since Fannie Lou Hamer. I mean, we can go Shirley Chisholm. We don't have no problem with the sisters running, winning. Because, hey, it's just, hey, it's their turn. You know what I mean? Now, there's some punk-ass brothers out there, but I'm just talking about by and large. So, that's why they angling towards these weak brothers. I'm voting for Trump. If your broke-ass vote for Donald Trump, we should take you in the alley and beat the hell out of you. For real. We should beat the hell out of you. But allow me to digress. We must create packs of our own so we can say, in LA, we need this. And if they don't get this in LA, in Oakland, and SAC, we ain't moving. We need this in St. Louis. We need this in Milwaukee. We need this in Dallas and Houston, so forth and so on throughout the country. If we're not willing to unite for a common cause, I'm not saying be everybody's damn friend. It seems that we have this misconception that if I'm not your friend, I can't work with you. No. None of that. I could be your damn enemy, but I could still work with you. Hey, since everybody loved Wakanda Forever, you saw, well, in the comic book, I don't know what they was calling him in the movie. In the comic book, they call him Man-Ape. The dude who challenged T'Challa. He wasn't rolling with that little council. He wasn't friends with them. But when push came to shove, he helped T'Challa take over from Killmonger. When you have a common enemy or a common threat, you must work together, even though I don't really trust with you or rock with you like that. That's the mentality. Everybody got Wakanda Forever and hoo-hoo and all that old cool shit about the movie. But you have to realize that was a situation to where as all 53, allegedly all 53 nations on the, would have been 54 Wakanda, but it's fictitional. But all 54 nations on the damn continent were working together for the greater good of the continent. Wakanda was kind of like the Washington, D.C. of the whole get down. But you saw all these nations working together. They may not have been friends. They may not have been seeing eye to eye. And even Buddy, who Get Out Buddy, he was from another nation, or he was working underhanded because he didn't see the big picture. See, but we have to be in a situation to whereas we're going to work together as a community on this continent of North America and get things taken care of. Because if we don't, this, hey man, when you got all these young people preaching, you see the thing, get down to Philadelphia, you see the get down to Minnesota, they had to get down here yesterday. People are tired. But while they're fighting the fight, we need to be organizing. We need to organize. Another thing, as we organize, we must be aware of what is called an agent provocateur. I mentioned this on the Tuesday show. I didn't do the sports show. I did this show, and I mentioned it Wednesday on the backyard, and I'm gonna mention it today. An agent provocateur. That's a person who infiltrates our infrastructure and attempts to destroy it from the inside out. What we have to be aware of is these situations will be prevalent for the remainder of the time that we are on Earth. There will be a sellout, sucker-ass brother, sister, niece, nephew, cousin in the get down. Understand that. We ain't finna be focused. And I did say finna. We not finna be focused on that because we know it's coming. We're gonna build a structure so strong that when the agent provocateurs and the sellouts and the traitors come along, we're gonna go up, blip on the radar. We're gonna keep it for moving. And an example of that is this. Those have been peaceful protests throughout the United States of America. If there have been some uprising and some nefarious activities, people looting and things like that, yes. But that is the result of agent provocateurs. If you don't believe that is true, all you do is go to TMZ when you see the sister in Philadelphia saying, why are you writing Black Lives Matter on that? Why are you doing that? That's not what we need you to do. And the dude is like, "But don't you hate Trump?" She was like, "Yeah, I do hate him, but that don't have nothing to do with that." Another thing, who the hell organized bricks, pallets of bricks to be set in the street? That's not a uprising or a protest. That's violence. And that's when you get rubber bullets popped at your ass and things of that nature. See, we have to be aware that it's this term called boogie. If y'all don't know what that is, that's a white supremacist term that they saw. Look, these people so weak that they saw the electric boogaloo. Boogaloo. They call it electric boogaloo. They took the electric away. And that's a term that they use. So when they put them bricks and stuff out there and they kick it off, the police attack us and then they attack us as well. Boogaloo. Look it up. Look it up in your urban dictionary. It's a real term. See, while we are angry, they are creating organizations to help attack us. It was a white nationalist on Twitter this week, and he said, at some point, the president will give us that dog whistle tweet. He didn't use the word dog whistle. I can't remember it, but basically, he's gonna give us this dog whistle tweet, and he's gonna tell us to attack y'all, and you are not even gonna know who's going to attack you. See, they're organizing. While we are being emotional, we have to remove the emotion from this. They are weak individuals. They're physically, mentally, and spiritually weak. And those are our strengths. So what we do is organize and move past those things. We don't have to fight their fight. We fight our fight. But we are willing to hurt you in the event it is necessary. You attack our children, you attack our women, you attack our seniors, and we will eradicate you. We will remove you from Earth. And that's the mentality what we have to have. And then stop using terms like what's the term y'all like they like to use? The term that they kill me when they use is this. We need to retrain the police force. Police. That's not training. Nobody has ever needed to train me on not killing somebody. The way the police is used, the way the police is being used force against us, that's not a lack of training. That is par for the course. That is par for the course. That's not, oh man, if we train them how to treat us, then they'll treat us better. No, they wouldn't. They just kick you in your head with different training. Nobody's ever had to tell you, hey man, don't kill somebody. Nobody has ever had to say that. Hey, I don't think you should kill anybody. I don't think you should put your foot on somebody's neck. I don't think you should hurt people. Nobody's ever had to train. That's not training that you need to have. This is a culture that is developed. So once you stop saying, oh, we're going to have to train them how to teach us. No, you don't. we're human beings. If you don't want your mama to get her ass kicked, you ain't gonna kick my mama's ass. So if you don't want your brother to have his foot knee on his neck, you're not gonna put your knee on somebody's neck. So training isn't the key. When you organize and you become strong enough to defeat whatever they have in front of you, then people come to the table and start negotiating with you like a human being. But see, we keep trying to work within a system that is inherently designed to stop us from succeeding. And when you know that, you have to fall back, regroup, and move forward. Another thing, like this back to the Asian provocateur thing. You know, in DC the other day, do you know all of a sudden pallets of water appeared on street corners? So, because nobody's falling for the brick get down anymore. But if you pick up water and the police show up, you throw the water, you get shot by the rubber bullet, and you get hurt. We have to always be thinking, as I stated, as the brother Joe Madison always says, you must listen with a third ear. You must watch with a third eye. Realize what's going on. And then you can prevent, as we say, the fuckboy shit. That's just it, man. We have to prevent it. Now, again, with this money thing, don't be bought off, please. Don't be bought off. Because when you allow these people to offer you money and funds, they will numb you to what's going on. We have missed two warnings in the last 16 years. The first warning was the brother Barack Obama let you know black has no legal standing on the Tom Joyner the morning show. Look, well, they probably scrubbed it from the internet at this point, but he's letting you know. When you see brothers like the brother from the Crip organization, Big U here, Rolling 60, he mentions it in those Vlad TV interviews that a lot of us watch. Look up a Black Laws Dictionary. Find out what's going on. This week in Chicago, I can't speak about anywhere else, Sister Lightfoot, a lot of us mad at her right now, whatever, but she offered you a way out as well. You had to be listening with a third ear. Sister Lightfoot said, I'm going to allocate over $10 million in small business situations. Now, a lot of us said, whatever, but I've been telling y'all about how to get that money, and this ties right back into voting your people into office. You vote in the right state representative, the right state senator, the right alderman, and then life will put that money out there for poor and disenfranchised communities. Don't get bamboozled like we got bamboozled in between 68 and 72 with the affirmative action. Affirmative action was created specifically for people that look like me and you. Specifically for people that look like me and you. So if it was created specifically for people that look like me and you, why is it that white women benefit from it the most? See, those are statistics that don't nobody want to talk about. You do hear white nationalists and these old trifling ass politicians always say, well, we don't like affirmative action. But white women benefit from affirmative action more than any group in the United States of America. Now, with that being said, when Sister Lightfoot put that money out there, what we need to be doing is getting in contact with one of our studious friends. Everybody got a studious friend. Everybody got a friend who know a lot about business. Everybody got a friend who's an idea fairy. I just happen to be one of the idea fairy dudes. Everybody got an idea that's willing to work and bust their ass with some connections. You and those people get together. Write out business plans, business proposals for small businesses like grocery stores, corner stores, and things of that nature. And put them in our universe so we can end these food deserts, as well as create these stores, corner stores, small grocery stores, and even a large grocery store if you can get the money for it. But if you're not willing to write out the plan, then guess what's going to happen? She said, these are for minority stores. Guess what? The Arabs going to get them. The Asians going to get them. The Latinos going to get all that money. But the Latinos, Asians, and Arabs, they already have stores. So if you don't take the time to get this money is your fault, because now that boulder is rolling downhill on top of your head. We don't have to continue to be left behind, brothers and sisters. What we can do is link up with somebody who knows a little something, and they know somebody who knows a little something, and so forth and so on, and get this foolishness out the way. I'm about to wrap this up, y'all, and I got one more thing. I've been speaking about not kicking brothers and sisters in the ass and doing all that type of stuff, but I was watching this special with the brother, Kenny and Ernie and Charles, and this is not the time. I'm gonna go back to the Drew Brees thing. This is not the time to tell white folks it's okay and pat them on their back and start caping for them. It's not the time for that. Charles Barkley and Shaquille O'Neal, aka Charles Barkley Jr., they on there caping for Drew Brees, and Shaq is talking about how he heard how the team, he was privy to their Zoom, and how the brothers in the locker room forgave Drew Brees, and the community shouldn't be mad at Drew Brees, and yada, 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 this, that, and the third. Look, I got some white friends. They some real good people. But I also know some white people that have said some ignorant shit around me, and I don't fuck with them no more. One of them is listening to the show right now. He got angry once and said the word nigga, and I bipped on his ass, and he apologized. I don't mess with him no more, but he's connected to some good white people I know. So when we see each other, we just nod, and that's it. I'm never going to speak up for him, because you know what? He destroyed all that equity he put out there with me by running that word, man. Yeah, I bipped on him, and it should have been cool, but it's not going to be cool, because you don't get angry. I don't get angry and call him a cracker, a honky, a peck of wood, or nothing like that. So don't get mad at another brother and use that word, man, or you're going to get fucked up. Charles and Shaq was up there caping for Drew Brees, and it took a white guy to step up and say, nah, man, he should know better. We ain't for that, man. See, when you are part of a righteous cause, righteous people will step up. I don't know if Ernie Johnson was serious, or I'm not finna take Ernie Johnson and put no post up of him in my den or nothing. But I appreciate the fact that Ernie had the wherewithal to say, look, Charles, Shaq, no. Cut it out. Knock it off. And that's what we do more times than not. I don't see legions of white reporters on CNN and all the other networks going, no, man, the brothers, the sisters, they cool. Yeah, just a couple of them. Or I know homeboy said something wrong, but yeah, come on, man. That's just one thing. No. So instead of putting that caping energy towards Drew Brees, I'ma ask everybody to cape for somebody on your camp. If somebody that had pissed you off in the last 6, 12, 8, 10, 5 months, whatever, give them some forgiveness. All but one person. I'm speaking for myself. I'm not forgiving that person. But I ain't going to ever meet them with no angst. But I'm not forgiving them. DJ Knox know what I'm talking about. But I'm not going to be angry with that person, but I'm never going to deal with them. But I'm asking y'all to step up. And if you have eyes for somebody, I'm not asking you to deal with them. I'm just saying, in the event that an opportunity comes about in which you can do business with this person, do business with them. Or if you have to support that person in a bad situation, because people who are opposed to our community are opposing them, step up to that. We don't have room to be angry with people anymore. We really don't. And with that being said, I want to thank each and every one of you guys for tuning in to Build for This Network. I want to thank y'all for tuning in to Build and Destroy. I'll be more prepared next week, y'all. I did all this right off the top of my head, and I done ran out of traction, man. I didn't have anything wrote down. I hope the show wasn't sloppy. I'm working with a new system because my computer crashed, so I'm still working the kinks out, you know what I mean? But I want to ask y'all to continue to support the network. Monday morning, support the number one chief rocker, Jersey Vern. Tuesday afternoon, support DJ Knox. Tuesday evening, support me. Well, number one chief rocker, Jersey Vern, in the Recap Entertainment Show. DJ Knox, I'm still begging him to talk more, but he going to fight me to the end. But on the Hip Hop Recap, Attack on Hip Hop Show, I'll be back with more sports, the whole get down, Tuesday. It was just not on my soul to talk about no damn sports Tuesday after what happened. But I'm coming back hard, like I'm avenging my brother's death Tuesday on the End of the Bench podcast. Wednesday, the brother, Big Illinois, going to be burning it down. He's going to be burning it down on the backyard, him, the homie Dre, my brother Dre, my sister Kim, my brother Anu, and maybe Big Jersey, Big D's are going to come back through. And then the best show, Miss, this is my personal favorite on the network, Cheers Roundtree and the homie Knox, Thursday evening with Theory of the Culture. Man, catch the show if you ain't caught it, man. Good shit, funny shit, informative shit. Clued in on it's just a good show. Then DJ Mukadeen, the Two-Step King, and then Friday Knox. Saturday mornings, you got DJ Purplicious. She burning it down with good music. Then I'm back in 167 hours, because it's like 166 hours. That's a week. 168 hours in a week. I ain't do the whole 2 hours a day. I want y'all to see my brother Jungle Brother. Jungle Brother down with Jesus. I need y'all to hit the follow on him. He got a 30-minute show that usually lasts about 2 hours. Super funny. Real good brother. Got a good soul. I want y'all tomorrow night to tune in to D-Grade on Esquire Radio. Follow the Esquire Radio people. D-Grade going to be burning it down with good music for the soul. D-Grade going to be killing it. Tomorrow night, good music for the soul. Monday night, it's Love. Monday night, Love Jones. Sunday night, Love Jones. And Westside Wednesdays for D Great. I don't think I saw anybody else in the Get Down in the chat room. And again, I'm working on a new system, so I ain't comfortable yet with this Get Down. But I want to thank each and every one of y'all. And y'all know how I end each and every one of my shows. I shoot it out to the Podfather, a.k.a. Reggie O'Shea, a.k.a. Combat Jack. Dream those dreams and man up and woman up and live those dreams. Because life without dreams flows in black and white. And life with dreams flows in technicolor and surround sound. Blow. See y'all next week. It's the Get Down. It's the End of the Bench. It's the Built for This Network. It's HRap B. It's Build and Destroy. We getting it in. Holla at your boy.
We are Built for This Network. For the strong.